In the previous lectures, we have tried to develop a multi-phase decision theory which you can use to solve ethical dilemmas. What we have told is, when an individual identifies an ethical dilemma, there should be a stepwise procedure that he should use to solve it. The procedure is something like this. In the beginning, you should collect as much information about the case as possible. First, collect all the information, speaking to all sides of the problem. Collect as much information as possible about the problem. Then try to see what is the central issue in that problem. Now see who can answer this central issue. Your first stop will be law. You have to ask whether law has something to say regarding this issue. If the law of the land has to say something about it, whether it passes a judgment that this is correct or this is not correct, then you have to note it down that the law has something to say about it and this is the legal opinion. We have said in earlier classes that if law does not permit something, that is the end of the story. But in reality, that may not be the case. There may be times when you want to go beyond law. So legal opinion can be one of the opinions you can take, and you can then move forward. Then ask, what does your professional code of conduct has to say regarding this? Does it have something to say? Is there a particular mention of this issue in the code of conduct? You note it down. Next, these are two formal mechanisms. One is law, second is code of conduct, professional code of conduct. These are formal. Then you come to informal realm. There you have the accepted social norms, which we call as etiquette. Then you have religious views, which a person may subscribe to. And finally, you have individual morals, which one firmly believes in. Now all these issues have to be taken together. Problem comes if one view clashes with other. Yesterday's newspaper had one such case reported in the New York Times, when there was this city official who was responsible for providing marriage licenses. She refused to issue marriage licenses for a gay couple. In US, in that particular state of US, now gay marriages are legal. But the lady said her moral conscience does not allow her to issue the marriage certificate. So she said, my individual morals is not allowing me to issue the certificate. The law has said you have to give the certificate. She said, I will not. She denied the certificate. And now she is put behind bars. See, what happens usually is, when there is a law which is a social good and there is individual morals which is individual good, whenever there is a clash between individual good and the larger social good, individual good has to fail. It has to come down. Social good has to win. This is the way society works. I can give you more examples in this. Say for example, construction of large dams. Always, when a large dam is constructed, they always do an assessment of how many people will be benefited due to it. It may be because of the drinking water collected. It may be due to the irrigation purpose, how much water has been distributed. So many advantages of building a large dam. Equally, there will be some number of people on the other side who will lose their ancestral lands, who will suffer displacement from their original places. Now this clash will always be there, what we call as human tragedy. Many literature works tries to highlight this fact. In fact, in Kannada, we have landmark stories such as Dvipa by Na D'Souza, which was made into a movie, or Puttakan Highway, which was again made into a movie. We have landmark works talking about this issue. Usually what happens is the larger benefit is taken into consideration. And we always say that there is some price to pay. And somebody has to pay the price for development. But there can be a solution for this. Instead of posing this as this many people will benefit and this many people will lose, that will become an unequal situation, right? So many people benefiting, small number of people getting trouble due to that will become an unequal situation. Then always the larger party will win. Instead of that, you should try to frame it as a rights issue. Rights issue. These people also have some rights. These people also have some rights. So now it is a clash between equals. Now you cannot say one individual's rights is more important than other person's rights. Then it becomes a good argument. So when you remember this, whenever you want to formulate an argument, if you are formulating your argument as an individual good, you are bound to fail. I remember a case of last year, same day, 5th September, I received a SMS. It was signed saying Prime Minister Narendra Modi. Initially, all of us got the SMS. Initially, all of us were like too very happy. It was the first time that you were getting SMS in the name of Prime Minister, saying that Happy Teachers Day, we are recognized, we are all that, blah blah blah. People always do this on Teachers Day. Initially we were all happy, even I was very happy. But then it got me thinking on how somebody got to know that I am a teacher. I safely guard my mobile number. I don't distribute it everywhere. I don't give it to shopping malls. I'm quite protective about that. Even in the official list of our college, my mobile number is not there. I have not given my mobile number officially. In the official listing. I may be a subscriber of some telecom company, but there is no way my telecom company can know that I am a teacher. Because I have given my house address, I have not given my college address. So there is no way they can link. But someone has taken the trouble of joining the dots and concluding that I should be a teacher. See, this is a very carefully done experiment, because a wrong message got to a wrong recipient will cause that kind of adversity among people. That wrong publicity nobody wants to take. For example, you are not a teacher and you get Happy Teacher's Day message. How will you feel? Except big PR disaster, right? They should be extremely careful on cross-verifying that indeed this is the list of real teachers. How did it happen? And if somebody knows, somebody sitting in Delhi knows that I am a teacher, then they should be knowing something more about me. They should be knowing what are my habits, where do I go, where do I shop, what do I eat. How do I pay? That got me thinking, and after that I became very uncomfortable with the whole situation. After looking into the matter, I found that India has started a massive online monitoring mechanism. It is called NETRA, N-E-T-R-A. It is a massive surveillance program which Indian government has started on its citizens. If you ask me, at an individual level, I am not comfortable with it. But at larger level, the arguments can be that this is required for national security. before some days when the suspected, a man who was suspected to have a hand in Mumbai bombing, when he was hanged, the government openly said that we are monitoring all the online forums and the mobile network to see whether somebody is playing mischief. So the Big Brother syndrome, which we thought existed only in the Western world, is a reality today in India. This issue we will take up in detail during the next lecture. But what I am trying to say here is, in this context, if you try to argue that as an individual I am uncomfortable with the state monitoring my activity, then your argument will fail. Because it is individual versus state. And state has a larger social group, national security. You can't say, because I am uncomfortable, national security should be compromised. You can't make that argument. So therefore, there is a need to put forward your argument in a more powerful manner. You should put it as a larger social group. How to do it, we will probably see in the next lecture. But right now, what I am trying to tell you is, whenever there is a clash between social good and individual good, you should bring up your argument of individual good as a social good. And that is where all the discussion we have made in the previous lectures should come handy to you. One question that you may ask is, all these discussions that we are doing here is basically because we as professionals face certain dilemmas in our everyday life and we should know how to solve it. That is why this whole subject has been introduced. Now we can always argue, we do have a large set of moral values which we derive from our religion. We have individual morals, we have etiquette, we have all these things. Aren't they sufficient for a professional also? Can't a professional work according to those things only? Why should a professional's ethics be discussed separately from normal ethics? Is there something called normal ethics and professional ethics? Good behavior is same for everyone. It is same for a sweeper, it is same for prime minister. Good behavior does not change with profession, right? So why a separate professional ethics has to be discussed? And is there something called as professional ethics which is different from normal ethics? The answer is yes. Yes, because as a professional, you have certain specific responsibility which others don't have. The difference between a sweeper and prime minister is this. Though prime minister sometimes takes broom and cleans the road, that's it. There is a difference. As a prime minister, he has some set of responsibilities which is unique to him, which comes with his power. Therefore, he should have different set of responsibilities. As who said? Spider-Man or Superman? Someone said, no?
Spider-Man.
With more power, comes more responsibility. So as professionals, we have certain power. Because we have that power, we should be more responsible. The more powerful we are, the more responsible we should become. That power comes to us because we are professionals. That is why a separate professional ethics is required. The focus of my today's lecture is on professional ethics. Why it is required is mainly because we as professionals, we are special. How special? Very special. Well, to put it in numbers, especially in our context, we have to say, how many engineering graduates are there in India? Every year. What is your annual intake? The number is approximately 8 lakhs. 8 lakhs. The intake of engineering professionals in India today is 8 lakhs. Approximately 8 lakhs. let me round it off to 10 lakhs, 1 million. Our population is 1 billion. In 1 billion, 1 million is chosen. Special. Maybe not, you can say this number is still large, but you are indeed special. Because among the people who come to engineering, who complete their engineering, statistics says only 8% of them pursue their post graduation. So among the 8 lakh people who join engineering and hopefully who complete it, only 8% of them join post graduation. So indeed you are now very special. So if you take 8 lakhs and 8% of it and then see 1 billion only, what is the number? It is indeed very small. In fact, doing PhD gives you to more exclusive club because only 0.05% of the total engineering graduates go on to this PhD. So it is a very, very exclusive club. So I hope you are convinced that you are in this exclusive group. Because you are exclusive, your responsibility increases. You have to understand that you have been given this opportunity over all others who have tried to make it but couldn't make it. Or maybe they didn't want to, whatever. The point is, there is an exclusivity in terms of ourselves also. Right? And therefore we should look at it in a separate way. This thing called profession, this word itself is not very old one. In fact, it has a very strange history. In today's context, it becomes more important because the word profession and the word professor both have emerged from the same root word. Who is professor? The one who professes is a professor. Why that word came? Profess. Andre, this is a religious interpretation. What used to happen in earlier days is teachers meant that teachers who came from a religious order, in Europe especially, they came from a religious order and they had professed themselves to the faith. As we discussed in our previous lectures, in any religion, professing the faith towards that God which the religion believes in and in that prophet is the first thing you have to do, right? You have to profess your faith. You have to say publicly that yes, I do believe in this God and I do believe in this prophet. That's the first requirement. Because they had professed, they were called professors. So they were conservatively religious people. They were drawn from religious order. They had professed and therefore they were professors. And the same meaning continued when they coined the term for profession. He who professed his work publicly was a professional. If you say publicly that this is what I am doing, then you are recognized as a professional. Public knows that you are providing this service. That is the meaning of this word profession, professional. But as such in everyday life also, we don't consider every work as professional, right? Are we professionals? What? Our ego tells us yes. Because when we came to engineering only, they said professional education. They said, right, professional education. We are professional. But we are not ready to grant this privilege to everyone. For example, somebody who is watering the plants over there, we are not ready to call him professional. Any paid work is not professional. Anybody who takes money for the service he gives is not a professional. Correct? Do we accept everybody as professional? When we use the term professional, there is something in our mind which we don't speak out, but the image comes up in our mind. What is that? a neat job, perfect job. That is why we even use the term such as professional killer. Professional killer. This is actually not correct because no killer comes out and professes himself in public. You see, I am a killer, please give me contract. Nobody will do that. Profession means he has to publicly say about it. Right? Recently, in Dharwad, a professor was killed. Police has said, this is a professional job. A professional has been. This is not right. Because a killer's job cannot be professional. Right? It's against the original terms of usage of this term, profession. So we do know profession means a neatly done, executed, the guy who is doing it knows what he is doing and he has done a good job and he charges the right price, all that we know. But if you go in deep and try to see what are the basic criteria for being a professional, there are only three. One, a professional should have special skills which he has gained formally through the education. That is very important. Second, he will be granted certain autonomy by the society, certain freedom to practice his profession, which is through licensing. That I'll come to it later. Third, every professional will have a set of responsibilities which every professional will tell you through their code of conduct. So profession means three things. There should be a formal education mechanism through which you train people. Second, you permit the practice of the profession through licensing mechanism. Third, you control their work through a predefined set of code of conduct. These three things are essential for a profession. I will come to this a bit later, but before that, let me very broadly try to sketch out the four pillars of professionalism. Please listen to this carefully. Not only listen, try to follow this. What does it mean to be a professional? First pillar of professionalism is commitment. Commitment. If you say you will do this by this time and date, you have to do it. Commitment is the basis of profession. Second is, once you have committed, you should take responsibility that you will finish that job. And then, equally important is, you should have the integrity to do it. And fourth pillar of profession is accountability. What if you don't do it? You should say, if I don't do this, this can be done to me. In ancient Greece, it is said that whoever was building the house, if the house he built came down, the person had the right to come to this builder's house and put his house down. Tick for that. You gave me a house, it came down, so I am coming to your house. That's extreme form of accountability. So every profession is built on these four pillars: commitment, responsibility, integrity, and accountability. All this, I feel the underlying principle is love for your job. If you love your job, these things will come naturally. If you don't love your job, this cannot be enforced. So the basis of the profession should always be love. You love your job. How can this happen? This can happen if you choose the right profession. You know your aptitude, then choose the profession, everything will be correct. If you choose the profession based on the numbers it will give you, then everything will be correct. So as professionals, if we have to be committed, if we have to be responsible, if we have to be integrative in our job, and if you have to be accountable, the basis is love for your job. So if we love for, if we love our profession, everything will become smooth. The next part I will discuss about the three aspects of people.